and the profound symbolism reward careful reading and research, not to mention the opportunity to speak to folks like you. I got Sirius Black right up here in front. Not often I get to do that. I did give a talk at Princeton once, and the entire place was witches and wizards. That's weird. This afternoon, though, Diana Patterson, one of my favorite medieval and Renaissance professors, is back there dressed as a witch. She's been haunting my lectures for too long. Right, this afternoon, though, I want to explore something more historical than literary, a puzzle or mystery evident in many seemingly unrelated pieces and details of the books. Working from the date of the International Statute of Wizarding Secrecy, 1692, and a bunch of data from Harry Potter canon, I want to argue that the witches and wizards of our favorite books come from a real-world Christian sect who all but disappeared at the end of the 17th century. This, of course, is laughably speculative. My best guess is simultaneously non-verifiable and impossible to be proven wrong, barring a remarkable change of heart on Miss Rowling's part and her speaking openly about such things. I hope she never does. Yeah, it'd ruin all my fun.
Aww.
For those of you who missed the days of speculation and intelligent guesswork before Deathly Hallows was published, however, this promises to be a bit of a flashback. Just to keep the speculation from wandering all over the map, I will start with a statement of my premises, the questions I hope to answer, and my working thesis. The premises I don't think are disputable. My first premise is that Joanne Rowling is remarkably attentive to details, especially with respect to names and sequences, and that there is meaning in these details. My second premise is that the International Statute of Wizarding Secrecy marks the defining moment in Muggle-Wizard relations. My conclusion from those two premises, which is also a premise, this is big geometry, is that the choice of 1692, therefore, is meaningful, not chosen arbitrarily or accidentally.
Stop.
The questions, really, this is the Walter Mitty experience, right? The Latin teacher gets to have this kind of thing. I brought my wife to one of these conferences just so she could see this.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Right. You're brilliant.
I grew the beard. I started to grow the beard, whatever, just so that my head wouldn't expand that much. Not working. Anyway, my questions are then, why 1692? And why does this date, what does this date tell us about wizards, especially those in the United Kingdom? And last, does this information help us understand Harry Potter any better than we did before? My thesis is that the end of the 17th century in England is the time at which a specific sect of Christian believers, the Hermetic spiritualists known as the Seekers, disappeared. The beliefs of this sect are the message in large part of the Hogwarts saga. I know that sounds dreadfully dull, and I'm afraid many of you are gonna leave here saying, gosh, that was dreadfully dull. He warned us and he told us the truth. Let's go into this. I mean, how many of you would travel great distances to hear about 17th century English history? Diane, I knew you would, right? I thought I'd be talking to you this afternoon, basically. All right, I have to start my speculation about 17th century English wizards in a place far, far from England in a time well before 1692. To lay the foundation for my argument, I want to go to a place and a time I can be reasonably sure are important to the Potter books, Renaissance Italy, and specifically the Florence of Dante, Ficino, and Pico della Mirandola. Actually, I should just be blessing now that I'm giving this talk while Diana is there. She'll correct me afterwards on all my mistakes. The Potter connections with Florence are remarkable. Let's start with the most obvious, Firenze the Centaur. Firenze's name is the Italian word for Florence. And we get a touch right away of what Ms. Rowling thinks is important about Florence in that the centaurs being both an astrologer and Firenze's being an astrologer who doesn't believe the stars' predestined fate. He, in effect, is a hermetic astrologer who believes that what is destined, it only opens up the field of choice. Maybe you don't like centaurs. We'll go to hippogriffs. These magical flying creatures are taken straight from the 15th and 16th century Orlando epics by Boiardo and Ariosto. the modern world's first heroic fantasy fiction work. And yes, only Diane and I think that that's modern. If you've read anything I've written or are familiar with Ms. Rowling's interviews, you know that literary alchemy is the internal logic of the series and sets the magical parameters of Harry's world. Alchemy comes to the West through Ficino's translations of Hermes Trismegistus, Corpus Hermeticum, and his incorporation of alchemical perfectionism into Christian doctrine with Pico Bruno and others. Let me talk about that for a second. Christian perfectionism is that your life in Christ is to be largely a return to Edenic perfection, largely a return to Adam's true state. This is largely the belief of the Florentine Hermeticists. Alchemy is a huge part of Harry Potter, and it comes out of Renaissance Florence. But you can also, if you study Renaissance Florence, you'll find the astrology, the memory-based magic, and tarot cards, which are also featured inside Harry Potter. These are all Florence items. Hogwarts is a school of four warring houses that have the qualities of the four elements. They are also historical ciphers for the four warring cities of Renaissance Italy: Florence, Naples, Venice, and Milan. I think, too, that the primary divide in the wizarding world, the age-old battle between the students of Godric Gryffindor and Salazar Slytherin, is mirrored in the Florentine civil war between the Guelphs and the Ghibellines. Which brings us to Dante. If you read my book, chapter 4 in this book, that's the only copy I've left. People this morning wiped out my book supplies or whatever. Aww. It is available online. And I hope you all got my card. Did someone pass out all the cards or whatever?
Yeah.
Even more up here or whatever. If you didn't get a copy of the book or whatever, you want me to autograph it, do the Gilderoy thing, I would gladly do all that. If you want to write to me and tell me how stupid I am, please take the card there.
What's it called?
What's the book called? Deathly Hallows Lectures. I didn't cue that. I don't even know who she is. That's another lecture.
Yeah, that was what we talked about this morning.
Which brings us to Dante and the Commedia. The Bard of Florence is a rolling favorite, clearly, as explained in the lectures, because of her lifting Snape's death scene and Lily's green eyes, the importance of Lily green eyes straight from the end of the Purgatorio. Joel Hunter is here, I won't bore him again, he's heard that lecture. And the epilogue, where we get to meet Albus and Rose. This is a reference to the climax of the whole entire Commedia, in which Dante's beatific vision is of the white rose. Rowling ends her book with her salute to Dante, and the books are largely organized on the alchemical principles of the Inferno, the Purgatorio, and the Paradiso. If you take away one thing from Florence, though, and why Miss Rowling points to it, let it be the hermetic or esoteric work of Marsilio Ficino and Giovanni Pico della Mirandola. They created a synthesis of mystical Christianity from the Orthodox East, Kabbalah studies from Spanish Judaism, and the occult sciences, alchemy, astrology, and memory from the Levant, that promised a way to divinization by manipulation of the sacred order of nature. According to these hermetic philosophers in Florence, the Renaissance, man was not subject to fate or destiny, but could exercise choice and the life and light within him to become divine himself. This esoteric alternative to orthodox, passive, devotional faith spreads across Europe and is a large part of the Radical Reformation. We're talking Radical Reformation. That's what you came here. You said, your friend said, you're going to Harry Potter conference. What are you doing? Radical Reformation. How do we get from the court of the Medici to the International Statute of Wizarding Secrecy in 1692? In a word, the Reformation. Forgive me here, but for me to make the connections I need to between Harry Potter details and the real world of 1692, I'm going to have to review one point of theology and at least one century of history. It's pretty straightforward, so just hang with me here. I promise. And the payoff is fascinating, at least to me. This is great, you're all victims. I suckered you with this morning's talk, and you talked about English history for an hour. Okay, the theological point is the heart of the Protestant Reformation, which is, in a word, primitivism. The reformers fought for a return to the ancient, uncorrupted, primitive church of the apostles, which they believed Rome had left behind with its church organization and ritual innovations. There were three degrees of primitivisms, which historians call conservative, liberal, and radical. The primitivism is pretty straightforward. Is if you're a Christian believer in the time of the Reformation, you're saying that Rome got it wrong and has added all these things onto the ancient apostolic church. And as a primitivist, you're saying, we want to go back to that church of the first centuries. Right? And there's three types of primitivists. The first one, the conservative ones, are what we recognize today as they call it in history the magisterial Reformation. These are your Lutherans. We used to say the Anglicans. I'm not sure what the Anglicans are anymore, right?
Episcopals.
These people felt that you didn't need much of a change to Rome. All you had to basically do was cut off the papacy and preserve the sacraments, and all was good. All was good. So that wasn't much of a change, and that would take you back to what the original church was like. Not much of a change. Those are the conservative primitivists. The next step down are those people, the liberal ones, they felt that it was a little tougher than that. That you also had to have some sort of separation between the church and the world. And these are your Puritans and your Pietists. They actually still exist within the church in passive obedience, but they're saying that you need much more than just to cut off the papacy to have a return to the primitive church. You have to have a real visceral relationship with the Bible and with the Holy Spirit. And the last group, the radical reformers, they say there ain't no way back. There ain't no way back. That we have gone so far afield from the ancient church that what we need is a new dispensation. What we need is a new revelation. Or they say there ain't no going back, period. There will never be another exterior church. And these two types, these two groups, I mean, the groups that say they're waiting on a new dispensation, these radical reformers are known by the same name. They're usually called the Seekers. The Seekers that survived until today, they're usually called the Literal Seekers. They were looking for a new dispensation, a new revelation. Today we call them the Disciples of Christ after the Campbellites, and we call them the Mormons. Because the Mormons, Joseph Smith's revelation was this new dispensation that the Seekers were waiting for. If any of you are Twilight readers, the reason that Carlisle Cullen is born in the mid-17th century is because he's a Seeker. He's a Seeker. And that's the beginning of the Mormon thing. She's a Mormon writer. Sorry, didn't want to hear that. All right. I was warned. Don't go to Twilight. Everybody just freezes up and says, I hate Twilight. Relax. Everybody, take a deep breath here. Okay. The other Seekers are called the Spiritual Seekers, and they said there ain't no going back, and there'll never be another exterior church. That the only way that you can experience the life in Christ is to awaken yourself to the inner light within you, your purified heart. Today, they don't have churches per se, they don't have rituals, they don't have creeds, they don't have sacraments, because all of those things are void and empty, because we have broken ourselves off from the original church and it's not coming back. Have you ever been to a Quaker meeting house? That's what that's about. They sit there and wait for the Holy Spirit to come down and speak through their members. There's no liturgy, there's no sacrament, etc. It's all the inner heart of the individual. Now, these Seekers, what was I going to say next? Okay. These literal seekers, the Italian and German students of the Florentine Christian Hermetics, Ficino translates all these texts, and he and Pico come up with an entirely new idea of man based on this, the whole idea of the Christian experience, and it bleeds into Europe. Through, especially, people like Jacob Boehm, Cornelius Agrippa, and Paracelsus, whom you recall, I assume, from your chocolate frog cards. They become the guiding lights of these spiritual seekers, and radical nonconformists pursuing perfection outside of any church's mysteries or ritual. And for a short period of time, the Commonwealth and Protectorate periods after the English Civil War, it seemed for a moment that these seekers, Christian hermetic magi, might win the day, which brings us to 17th century England. We got our scorecard of players here. We basically have Catholics and the Reformation. Sorry, they're the bad guys. Right. We've got the Church of England, who actually does a pretty good bad guy impersonation too during this period. They're heavies. Then we have the Puritans, who are basically trying to make the best of a bad situation. And then we have the seekers, who are condemned. Well, we'll get into it with how they relate to those things. That's our scorecard. You have your scorecard of all the players on the pitch in the nightmare of 17th century England. Let me tell you, if you ever get your wish to jump into a time machine, the place you don't want to go, I'm telling you, the place you don't want to go is 17th century England. All right? It starts off okay. As the century begins, England is a Protestant nation experiencing a renaissance of arts, business, and culture under Queen Elizabeth. And you say Shakespeare in love. I mean, this is a fun place.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great place. Elizabeth dies in 1603, and the problems really start to roll off. Mm-hmm. James I ascends the throne of both England and Scotland. He dies in 1625, and Charles I becomes king. Charles I pushes the prerogatives of the king so far as head of church and state, however, that civil war breaks out and rages for the better part of a decade, most of the 1640s. And Charles is beheaded by Act of Parliament in 1649. Very lively time. They estimate between 5 and 10% of England dies during that decade in the English Civil War. So again, not your place to visit. Not your time machine first stop. The Protestant roundheads, so-called because of their distinctive bowler haircuts, under Oliver Cromwell, ruled the land as a commonwealth and a protectorate until 1660, when Charles II becomes king in what is called the Restoration. But the restoration of a king and head of the state church isn't without opposition. The seekers and nonconformist Puritans, not to mention Catholics, were also being persecuted by the state church, newly invigorated. They rise up in something called Venner's Rising, 1661. And Charles both crushes the rebellion and passes a series of acts to repress the radical sects and the Catholics. I bore you silly. I'll read you some of these acts, all right? The Corporation Act of 1661, the Church of England requires that its communion is required of all public officials. Catholics and nonconformists are consequently excluded from public office in Oxford and Cambridge. In the Act of Uniformity in 1662, the Book of Common Prayer is required in all church services, and clergy must be ordained by Anglican rite. In the Conventicle Act of 1664, no meetings of more than 5 people are allowed in worship outside of Church of England gatherings. This gets better. The 5-Mile Act of 1665. Diane, nodding your head. This is great stuff. The nonconformist preachers are forbidden to come within 5 miles of towns. Meaning, I love that, the 5 miles. Meaning that if they stood on top of a mountain, they yelled, they had a 5-mile range or whatever, that was supposed to go. And then we get the Test Acts of 1672 to 1678, in which one has to offer proof that one does not believe in Catholic ideas of transubstantiation. The Catholics take the worst of this, really, in that they are effectively prisoners within the United Kingdom until 1828 in the amnesty for Catholics. This is something we don't really get in American history books, right? That when the English king comes back, he comes back with a hammer. And the first thing he goes after are the Catholics, yes, but he also goes after these radical sects, these seekers. The reign of Charles II, that isn't the only bad stuff that happens during the 16th century. The reign of Charles II is marked by the Great Plague. Don't you love it? as things weren't bad enough. Again, the bubonic plague comes through England in 1665 to 1666 and takes off about, what, 10 to 12% of the population. They're still trying to figure out how many people died because the bodies were everywhere. And if you're in London, you think to yourself, woo, survived the plague. 1666, the Great Fire rolls through and takes England, it takes London right to the roots. Wow. Do things get better? Not really. If this weren't enough, though, Charles II dies without children, so James II takes the throne, a king who is a secret and then not so secret Catholic. When his wife gives birth, his Catholic wife gives birth to his son, Englishmen rise up for fear that they're about to have a Catholic dynasty on the throne. James tries to loosen the laws against Catholics. That makes sense, right? he offers what are called the Declaration of Indulgence to repeal the Test Acts, and oops, he's given a free pass to another country. William II of Orange takes the throne in 1688 in what is called the Glorious or the Bloodless Revolution. And we have a Protestant king at the end of the century, the way we did at the beginning of the century, and though we've lost a whole lot of English people to the fire, to the plague, and to the Civil War, we're almost back to where we started. We're just short of about 25% of the population that we had before. What were our perfectionist and radical primitivist seekers doing during this century of political upheaval and religious persecution? The ideas of the German Radical Reformation and of the Florentine Hermeticists come to England in the 1590s, care of three brothers. The three brothers are Walter, Thomas, and Bartholomew Legate, two of whom are burned for heresy, and the third brother disappears. Seekerism as a religious movement only begins to grow in significantly, though, during the chaos of the Civil War, largely due to the translations and preaching of a Cambridge scholar named John Everard. He translates the German radicals and Ficino's work on alchemy as well, and preaches an antinomian perfectionist seeker doctrine of spiritual alchemy. John Everard. The seekers play a large part with the roundheads of Oliver Cromwell in the Civil War. One of Cromwell's chaplains was a seeker, an Everard disciple, and some say that Cromwell himself had seeker tendencies and beliefs. Of course, the acts of religious repression are pointed at Catholics and seekers both after the Restoration and the Glorious Revolution. So we have the seekers in England. We have them rising to a peak during the English Civil War, when the radical reformers are taking charge, and then at the Restoration and the Glorious Revolution, they take it right in the neck. They're the ones who are most repressed by the Church of England heavies. The spiritual seekers who are perfectionists as well as radical primitivists and nonconformists disappear into the Quaker movement of George Fox. These pious pacifists, however, during the persecutions of Charles II, James II, and William II, shed in large part the magical, hermetic, even occult beliefs of the Italian Renaissance. In brief, the Christian hermetic magi of John Everard vanishes into history. In 1692, give or plus 4 or 5 years, either way. So what? Well, we have a bunch of Harry Potter connections here that point to a historical connection between the magical Christian seekers and the wizarding world that went underground in 1692. We've got those three Levante brothers, two of whom die, bring the seeker faith to England, and have their shadow, perhaps, in the tale of the three brothers in Beetle the Bard, the story of Harry Potter's ancestor who survives under a cloak of invisibility. John Everard is the heart and engine of English seekerism, and we meet him complete with round head haircut in Dumbledore's office in chapter 22 of Order of the Phoenix. Dumbledore dispatches Everard, whom he calls one of Hogwarts' most celebrated heads, to find Mr. Weasley at the ministry after Nagini's attack. The seekers, of course, are mentioned by name in every Quidditch match. They are the star players who fly above the conflict of contrary teams in search of the golden snitch, which flying gold ball is a symbol used in alchemical texts for the philosopher's stone. When the seeker achieves this perfection, the game is over. We have, too, all of the references to Florence and Hermetic arts, none of which are used fatalistically, as Calvinists might, but to reveal choices to be made. We have the chocolate frog cards for Agrippa and Paracelsus, the perfectionist and primitivist masters. And we have the Muggles. The only enemy that the Quakers had among radical nonconformists, curiously enough, during the age of persecution, were the Muggletonians. The Muggletonians were a sect who denied the existence of a church like our seekers, but who also thought human perfection was impossible, that there was no magic or divinization possible. Muggles. Okay. Let's look at the three questions I said I wanted to answer today. Why 1692 for the International Statute of Wizarding Secrecy? What does this date tell us about wizards, especially those in the UK? And does this information help us understand Harry Potter better? One at a time. Why 1692? 1692 is the date of the Salem witch trials and the death of George Fox, the leader of the Quakers, whose miraculous healings distinguished the early movement. As reflected in the Puritan attack on magical Christians in Plymouth Bay and the Seekers in Rhode Island, Roger Williams' sect were largely made up of seekers, very much like our radical Reformation times. It was a time of great persecution of seekers in the United Kingdom. Miss Rowling chooses 1692 not arbitrarily or accidentally, but deliberately, because she means to tell us through this, as she has with her many other pointers. We've got Florence Ferenczi, the Dante scenes, the frog cards, the alchemy, the astrology, the memory magic, the symbols of Christ and the resurrection, the seekers in Quidditch, Nicholas Flamel, John Everard, the three brothers, and the Muggletonians, like Muggles, that the wizards and witches of her story are the descendants of the seekers, Christian Hermetic Magi, who survived through the centuries under the invisibility cloak of the Statute of Wizarding Secrecy. They disappeared when the radical spiritual seekers disappeared, because they are the same group, which answers our second question. What this tells us about United Kingdom witches and wizards is that they are Christians, for one thing, but Christians pursuing perfection in Christ outside of any church or exterior ritual. Theirs is an interior perfection of the inner light and heart. Does this help us to understand Harry Potter more meaningfully? I think so. Miss Rowling shows a passage from William Penn's Fruits of Solitude, which was published in 1693, and then again a different edition in 1702, as one of the epigraphs for Deathly Hallows. And she said in an interview that these epigraphs just say it all to me, they really do. I'd known it was going to be those two passages since Chamber was published. I always knew if I could use them at the beginning of book 7, that I'd queued up the ending perfectly. If they were relevant, then I went where I needed to go. William Penn, of course, is the world's most famous Quaker, and his epigraph reflects the Hermetic teachings of the radical seekers about the conjunction and immortality of believers, friends, in the mirror of God's word or logos. In case you haven't got that passage memorized, let me read that. Death is but crossing the world as friends do the seas. They live in one another still, for they must needs be present that love and live in that which is omnipresent. In this divine glass, they see face to face, and their converse is free as well as pure. This is the comfort of friends, that though they may be said to die, yet their friendship and society are, in the best sense, ever present, because immortal. When Penn says, they must needs be present, all of those who may have seemed to have died, they live those friends that love and live in that which is omnipresent. If you were at this morning's talk, we talked about the logos within. And he talks here, too, about the mirror, the glass, about the known object and the knowing subject being coincident. He's talking about Christian epistemology and our shared life in Christ. It's a mystical, natural theology that Christians observe, and especially those Christians like Penn who are radical nonconformists. Penn writes that book, War Fruits of Solitude, from jail, where he's been put for preaching within that 5-mile limit. I explain an essay in the new Potter Pundit's book. How Penn's inner light and spirituality reflects the alchemical and heart symbolism of Harry Potter, which are the artistry and meaning of the series. I think it does help us to understand the series more meaningfully. 3 quick points before we go to questions, before you do the play applause thing. The first point, is this is entirely speculative. I'm waiting for Diana to say, John, you are so embarrassingly far off in this. But I hope you thought that this was fun. I certainly enjoyed following the clues to the historical reference. 2, and I think funniest about this, is that this makes Christian objections to Harry Potter that much more ironic. Because the historical seekers, our witches and wizards, were driven underground by other Christians as well. It's fitting somehow that the descendants of seeker persecutors would attack Harry and company as well. And my last point is, please do read Deathly Hallows Lectures and the Potter's Pundit's book if you honestly want to know more about this. And please write to me about what you think. Really, I get to do this about once a year. I get to put on my Harry Potter hat and come out and talk to all these people. It's the people I meet here and the conversations I have that make all this worthwhile. Thank you so much for being attentive through this long historical talk. Go ahead. Woo! Let's do questions. There's one right over there.
Yes, I like the lecture and the point you made seem really valid. However, J.K. Rowling has also said in interviews that she's joining the English church, that she's been attending the sermons. So where does that
go? Join Rowling's church. Let's talk about this.
Excuse me. Yeah.
It's a great point. She is in a group, a church that is the Church of Scotland, which is in the Anglican Communion, which is a church roughly the size of this stage, I think. Anglican Communion, of course, is very large worldwide, especially in Africa. But the Church of the Anglican Communion in Scotland is very small. And she grew up in England, and she grew up inside the English church. She went to church by herself. Her parents did not go to church, and she went to church regularly until she was 17. Basically, until she left comprehensive and went to college. But the Church of England is a very wide umbrella, and basically, she can believe what she wants to believe inside that, or whatever, right? It's a good place to raise a family and this and that. But is Miss Rowling a conventional Christian? I think the answer to that is no. She's not. Diana, go ahead.
Church of Scotland, no bishops.
She's not at the Church of Scotland. The Church of Scotland would make her seem like a Presbyterian to us, but she's in the Church of Scotland Anglican Communion.
Oh, I thought she was.
Have I researched this one. I will send an email to all of you if I am wrong, so make sure you write to me and I'll get up. She grew up Church of England and she's still Anglican Communion. She's the equivalent in Scotland of what the Episcopal Church USA is in terms of the relationship to the Church of England.
Going off of what you said, and assuming that, as you say, this is all speculation, but let's just assume for the moment that your speculation is 100% correct. just for the purpose of the
question. That's what I'm doing.
Do you think the fact that the wizarding community was driven underground, that many of them were a Christian sect that was driven underground, do you think that necessarily means, or do you think there's any indication within the text that means that the wizards of today are still Christian? They may still be spiritualists, they may still be absolutely practicing some of these foundational principles, but do you believe that they are, and obviously get into what
here's the real answer to that. Who are these Christian hermetic magi that have survived through the centuries? What have they been doing all these centuries? Where have they been under their invisibility cloak? They've been writing fiction. They've been subverting muggle minds and winning their hearts to the truth through works from the Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner and Coleridge and all of his natural theology, through George MacDonald's works, through Lewis Carroll's works, to the Inklings, Lewis Carroll Sayers, that whole crowd. Charles Williams, certainly. We see these Christian hermetic magi working their magic, basically through literary alchemy. You enter into their stories, you identify with their main characters, you experience the catharsis up with those characters, your heart is changed. Your soul's faculties are turned right side up, so you're oriented around your heart. These are those writers, those brilliant men that decide to spend their life writing children's stories, are these magi trying to communicate to us Muggletonians. And without them, our world becomes a world of engineers, mechanics, and charcoal burners, to use the word that the alchemists use for the false alchemists. The reason that we're all here, the reason we come to faraway places to talk with friends and serious readers about the meaning of literature, is that we know that our lives have been touched and changed, really transformed in light of story. Mercy Eliade says in a secular culture that entertainments, especially novels, serve a mythic or a religious function. When God has been pushed to the absolute periphery of the cultural square, then we have to have some experience in story of the transcendent and the absolute. Those hermetic magi that she writes about, she's one of those magicians. She's one of those wizards that brings us some experience of the resurrection, some experience of the unity of the human brotherhood. She brings that to you inside the story that you enter, how you're transformed. Great question. Joel Hunter, the man. This is embarrassing to be asked a question by this guy. You should be answering the question, but go on.
Not at all. I'm really excited because a lot of what you've talked about here complements what I hope to do tomorrow. But I'm really interested in the historical angle is important. You mentioned the socio-political dimension to what you're talking about, though, because the Seekers had their predecessors, correct me if I'm wrong here, in the Diggers and the Levelers of 1648-49, which was a group of anarcho-communist Christians who were completely annihilated by the power structures of the institutional church and the government. And it seems to me that your thesis rings true in this regard with Rowling appropriating that tradition in order to, as you said in your first lecture, speak truth to power. Because it's through nonviolence and embracing, you know, the other that's done through peaceful means. So I'm here to echo and say, yeah, go.
Yeah, yeah. What's your lecture tomorrow?
11, thank you.
I hope we'll all be there. It's going to be good. Seriously, Ms. Rowling's political. She's a radical liberal in her own right, and she's a nonconformist to the extreme. She says to all of her readers repeatedly, don't trust the establishment or the press to tell you the truth. And the establishment includes every vehicle of the meta-narrative
every power source, to include the government, the schools, and the media especially, but basically includes everybody that wants to tell you what to think. She's, you use the expression anarcho-communist, because that's largely what she is. Anyway, pretty far afield, but yes, I absolutely agree with you. Serious. You gotta stand up, you gotta see this. I mean, this is the
Woo!
Thank you. Do you think that the witch trials are also equally significant to this, or do you think that it's more another philosophy and more coincidental and on another continent?
My fellow Potter pundit, James Thomas, in the back there, I was boring my friends at lunch today with what I was going to say, and he said, but John, Rowling says 1689 in the books until Fantastic Beasts comes out, where we get 1692, and then she says 1692. So it wasn't originally 1692, but I think she shifted it because of the Salem witch trials. Now, in the United States, we see the Salem witch trials as just an outburst of anti-witch madness inside the Plymouth Bay Colony. But the antagonism within the New England colonies is between Roger Williams' Seeker colony in Rhode Island and the Plymouth Bay Puritans, who are passively obedient to the Church of England. And so this tension between those two poles explodes in 1692, relatively soon after the Glorious Revolution, especially given the transportation of news back and forth from the United Kingdom to its colonies, that this sudden outburst of persecution of witches is largely an attack on the conservative church's part. Even though it's a popular outburst, it's an expression of their angst about this Christian hermeticism and perfectionism. That the magical things are bad and dangerous and horrific, and while in Rhode Island they're saying, actually, no, that's Christianity. Do you get that? We didn't get that in our American history classes.
No, not at all.
We don't get any of the background and the drama of why the Puritans even come to the United States is largely this religious nightmare. And we don't get also that a lot of the drama, the Protestant drama in England, is a reflection of the French Catholic absolutism of the same century. Anyway, much more than you wanted to hear, but yeah, the 1692 is almost definitely a pointer to the Salem witch trials.
Perfect, thank you.
I got 10 minutes without any more questions. There she is.
Take it to a different country.
Different country, she says.
Different country and different century. How does this relate to the Spanish Inquisition?
I don't think it does. The Spanish Inquisition gets a pretty bad rap. But if you're in your time capsule and you've ducked 17th century England, you broke that part of the little dial there, says no, not going there. If you do wind up in the Spain of the Spanish Inquisition and you get into trouble, you want to appear in front of the Spanish Inquisition rather than the secular courts of the time. You're going to get a much better trial from the Inquisition than you are from the regular courts. And that isn't to say that the Inquisition didn't go overboard and kill a lot of people that they shouldn't kill. But it is to say that the Spanish Inquisition gets a comic rap from the Hundred Years' War, in which the Dutch and Diana Plenier basically spread a great lie about the Spanish Inquisition as being this horrific Catholic attack on the world or whatever. It's very much exaggerated.
Hi, John. Denise Roper.
She's John's wrote several wonderful books.
Just one. I wanted to make a comment, and then I have a question. The comment was, I've been to Florence, Firenze, and I noticed that the official emblem of the city is a lily, specifically a red lily. And if you wanted to elaborate on that, I'd love to hear about it. But you mentioned the four Italian cities, corresponding maybe to the four houses. I haven't been to Venice, but I know their emblem is the winged lion of St. Mark's. I don't know about the other two cities that you mentioned. But my question really isn't about that. I wanted to ask, do you think that J.K. Rowling...
Denise should be up here.
Come to my talk Saturday at 5. It's on Lewis and Rowling. Off topic. Anyway, my question is, during the century that you talked about today, there were a number of Catholics martyred in England. And I wanted to know, do you think that Rowling is sympathetic with those Catholics who were martyred? And how does this relate to Guy Fawkes, or was Nicholas Flamel a Catholic too? So you probably know more than me about this.
Okay, Rowling, obviously I've never met Ms. Rowling. I have no idea. I grew up in largely the same environment, believe it or not, though, on this side of the Atlantic as Ms. Rowling. I grew up as a Episcopalian. I grew up as a classicist. I grew up reading these books, and I grew up reading a lot of alchemical works. So when I read the books, I was able to see certain things. But I don't really know how Ms. Rowling thinks. I would bet, though, that anybody who is a martyr has Ms. Rowling's sympathy. She is for the downtrodden first and always. To your other questions about Nicholas Flamel is certainly a Catholic. He's a deacon, as I recall, in the church. This is a stage, though he's 14th century. This stage of belief, where the Hermetic beliefs of Florence bleed into the rest of Europe, really infects and shapes a large part of the character of the Reformation. Because revolutions are always shaped from their periphery. And a huge piece of the periphery is this Hermetic doctrine of the Florentines. Now, you said that the seal of Florence was a red lily.
It's a red fleur-de-lis. You see it everywhere in Florence.
Okay, the lily is, you see it in iconography in two spots. It's considered to be, you see it in all icons of the Annunciation, primarily. The Archangel Gabriel comes to the Virgin Mary and bears a lily. And this is because the Annunciation is considered to be the archetype of the resurrection, when the Christ is born within the Virgin Mary. And the reason, that's the same reason that lilies are put on dead bodies, is that that person is waiting for the resurrection from the dead. Now that, to have a red lily, though, points to a possible alchemical meaning. Because the lily is usually the second stage of alchemy. The lily is usually a sign of the white work, much like the swan or the moon or silver. It's usually a sign of the white work, the purification. To make a red lily, though, suggests that it's come to a crisis. It's come to the end. It's come to the philosopher's stone. For example, I don't think, is there a red lily in nature? There is. Diana says, yes, there is.
It's in my garden.
It's in your garden. Okay. Is it relatively rare? No, she says. Okay. But I'd like to hear more about that. Thank you, Denise. And your talk tomorrow is at 5. You'll want to see that. Denise is wonderful.
You have 5 minutes, but the room is empty after.
Oh, is that me? We all might want to leave, but yeah. I will be signing. I only have these three books in one copy, so the first person runs up and gets those. But this one, I've got a bunch of them. You want to buy those. And the Potter Pundits will all be here tomorrow afternoon. James is back there now. We can sign all those and do that. All right. More questions? There he is in the back.
About what everything that you said might have to do with the international wizarding world and sort of the history of other places?
No, but you don't get that backstory. Ms. Rowling has said that she has three boxes of notebooks of backstory. And we know that she just reached into those boxes and pulled out Fantastic Beasts and the Quidditch history, just pulled it out. She's got huge pieces of, remember, because the Harry Potter story is told from that minicam over Harry's head. It's only a slice of the story that she knows told in a specific way, but she has the whole panoramic available to her. She, for example, she says that she has full biographies written for every character whose name is mentioned in the books. Every character who is sorted by the sorting hat has a biography in those notebooks. Do you doubt that Victor Crumbs and his school has got a full book? I don't. It's out there. But I can't speculate about it because she hasn't opened that book to us. Will she ever do it? I'm pretty confident that she's going to. Why? Because, sorry with the rhetorical questions. I'm confident that she is going to be opening up these things. I'm confident she's going to write another Harry Potter story because she has created a charitable empire.
She has created, I mean, we have the novel franchise, we have the film franchise, we have the theme park now. I should look in one direction, right? Over there. But, and this again, as I said this morning, this is the largest story event in human history in terms of scale and spread. But with that, she has created obligations for herself to multiple charities. She needs to create income to support these endeavors that she's undertaken. For example, when this eighth movie is done, the seventh and a half movie is done, you have to understand that Warner Brothers is now making $1 billion a film.
Oh my God.
Now, I don't know about you, but my guess is that Warner Brothers would like another one. Anybody? Warner Brothers is going to say, wow, that was a great ride. Let's just go on the next one. I bet that Warner Brothers, being fairly clever, goes to Ms. Rowling after an appropriate period of time, say 15 minutes has passed after that. And he says, you know, dear, you've got all these things you want to do. You want to cure MS. You want to help all these orphan children in cages in Central Europe. Mm-hmm. You want to, raise the dead and heal the lame. Here's $500 million. Just write us a story. Yeah. Make it about Harry Potter. I don't know about you, but my guess is that Rowling looks at that check and thinks, you know, that'll probably cash. My bet is she opens a drawer, pulls it out, and says, how about another check? I'm pretty confident she's got that story already written. Either a prequel or a sequel. People talk about the end of Harry Potter, I just have to roll my eyeballs. This is a very young woman who's really just started her writing career. And we have a story franchise which is so huge, that it will almost be impossible for her to turn down the kind of money that they'll throw at her. I'm fairly confident in that. I also have my fingers crossed.
Yeah.
Next question. Well, the Muggleborns are largely Rowling's postmodern, politically correct attack on the purebloods. They got to have somebody there that mm-hmm. the purebloods can look down their nose at, right? Instead, they're born. It's also, I mean, just to the point of this talk, is that it's not about the church that you're born in. It's not about the rituals and this and that. A lot of this just comes, a person feels the call of their heart, and they feel that magic and they're called to this. Does that make sense? This is great. Look at the microphone.
It's so great.
Oh, great. She's right back there. It's great.
Thank you. Would you like to speculate at all on...
Sure.
On... wait till you hear.
Wait for it.
On the future of Albus Severus Potter Asp.
Oh yeah!
And
oh yeah, I got a whole story. I'm really written!
Is he going to find the three Deathly Hallows, which all still exist?
No, I got a better story than that.
Aww.
This isn't mine. If you go to my website, please do, hogwartsprofessor.com, the Deathly Hallows came out.